Hi, everyone, and welcome to Demystifying Parkinson's Research. So I am Sarah Osborne. I am the program manager for Parkinson's Foundation, and joining me today from the Parkinson's Foundation, of course, Danielle and Paulo. We also have Kayla Lozano and Lauren Williamson joining us. So first, always, we have to thank the sponsors who make these things possible. We have our gold sponsor, AbbVie. We have Kirwa Kieran and Boston Scientific. And Amneal, thank you so much for your support. We invite you to learn more about them by visiting our chapter supporter page. Also, many of them are here in the meeting today. So if you see those names beside anybody else's names, you can direct chat to them and ask any questions. The mission of the Parkinson's Foundation is to make lives better for people living with Parkinson's today until there's a tomorrow without the disease. And we work towards this mission by supporting better care for Parkinson's, education, and research. So show of hands, or you can write it in the chat, how many of you have an Aware and Care kit or some of our books? Awesome. Yeah, so these are probably what we're best known for. This is probably you all know about the webinars because you're here today. We also have a PD Health at Home series. We have the Aware and Care Kit. We have books, fact sheets, and then we also have a professionally staffed helpline, which is 1-800-4-PD-INFO. So in addition to funding research projects, we also work through our Centers of Excellence, which is a network of 47 centers worldwide, to carry out research ourselves, including our newest initiative, PD Generation. So this is a study of the genetics involved in Parkinson's disease, and it includes genetic testing and counseling at no cost to participants, and now it can be done from home. So that's the website if you wanted to find out more. And then another show of hands, or write it in the chat, how many of you have done one of our walks? This walk is actually a picture of LA. So I'm gonna invite Lauren Williamson to jump on and tell us a little bit about what's going on in Orange County. So Lauren.
Thank you, Sarah. As Sarah mentioned, we do have our Moving Day walks. We have one coming up in Orange County this spring. This year, due to COVID, it'll look just a little bit different, but we're still finding creative and fun ways to get the community together. So on May 22nd will be the virtual portion of our Moving Day Walk, which will include an interactive online platform where people can pick and choose the aspects that they want to participate in and hear and see local community members. And we'll also have a drive-through happening on May 21st as well. So we'll also have the opportunity to bring people out. And then in the 6 weeks leading up to the event, we'll be planning special movement days to really help encourage and inspire people to get out and continue moving, which is what Moving Day is really all about. So we hope that you'll join us for any or all of that. You can visit movingdayorangecounty.org for more information or to get registered. We are also going to do a little contest with some prizes today, or a challenge, I should say. If you contact me via email or text message or even in the chat box here on Zoom today to get registered for Moving Day Orange County, then you will be entered to win a fitness tracker in a raffle that we will hold afterwards. And this is just during the program today. So of course we want to have you out whenever you can register, but if you do it during the program and let me know that you want me to sign you up, then you will be entered. So we really hope that you will join us, and I'll let Sarah take back over.
Thank you so much. Okay, so again, we're grateful for everyone's participation. We want you to stay in touch on our website, social media channels, and by phone or email. So I just want to let you all know that all the links and all the resources that we share today in the chat will also be sent to you by email after the event. So copy of the slides, everything that all the resources, all the information will be sent to you after. Okay, so we can get Dr. Claire Hinchcliffe on screen. There she is. Hi. Dr. Claire Hinchcliffe is a board-certified neurologist at UCI Health who has specialized in the diagnosis and treatment of movement disorders for more than 20 years. Prior to becoming chair of the UCI School of Medicine's Department of Neurology, Dr. Hinchcliffe served as Weill Cornell Medicine's vice chair for clinical neurology research and chief of neurodegenerative disorders. So welcome and take it away.
Thanks so much. So I, first of all, first time that I've been working with you guys, I want to say thanks so much to the Parkinson's Foundation for setting this up. This is just a fantastic program. Thanks to everyone who's attending. And, you know, too bad that we need to do this by Zoom, but it lets people access this program very easily and conveniently, and hopefully you're all comfortable at home. And I hope to get to meet some of you sometime in the future. And I also wanted to say how thrilled I am to be presenting alongside some of the other presenters on here. I think it's going to be really, really interesting. And particularly, you know, I've known Dr. Litvan for a long time now, so I'm really privileged and very proud to be presenting with her. All right, I'm starting my timer. Let me kick this part of the program off, and I want to talk a little bit about Parkinson's research. I've been working in research for more years than you want to know, and in Parkinson's research, I started about 25 years ago when I was training, started off in the laboratory, and then really got interested in how new treatments and new interventions can be tested in clinical trials. So that's really what I'm going to focus on in this talk, and I hope this is helpful for you. So let's move on to the next slide. This is just a bit of an overview, and I think when you get into any particular field, it's sometimes like listening to a foreign language. So I want to help you learn the language. I've spent years doing this. I want to talk a little bit about what you can expect if you participate in clinical studies. And I'm sure many of you have already done this, so I'm not going to be telling you anything new, but I hope that this is going to be helpful for people who are thinking about maybe they want to participate or wondering what this is all about. And then I want to get into some tough questions about clinical trial participation and look at some of the myths that are out there and see if we can dispel some of those. And then the really fun part of the talk for me is to talk about some of the exciting current clinical studies that are going on in Parkinson's. And it is such an active time for research right now. In all the years that I've been working with people with Parkinson's and in the research field, I've really never seen a more exciting time. So I hope to convey some of that to you. Let's start out the most basic question. This is a little bit like the what is research question. And I admit I stalled when I saw that question. And I really was impressed with the answers that you came up with. So let's take an easier one. What is a clinical study? Well, a clinical study is basically research in humans using human volunteers. And the volunteer part of that is a really important thing. Now, when you get into the clinical study, we don't call you a patient anymore. We are going to call you a clinical trial participant or a clinical study participant or a subject in that study. And the aim of the clinical study, the reason for calling you a participant or a subject and not a patient is the aim of the clinical study is really to add to medical knowledge. The aim isn't to provide you with care at that time, because usually if something's being studied, it's not usually known whether it works or not, and there can be risks associated. So I'm going to talk more about that in a few minutes. And there are two types of clinical studies. So there's the clinical trials, and that's often what we think about first when we're talking about clinical studies, right? And those are also called interventional studies. And then there's the observational studies. And the observational studies are also incredibly valuable, and we have learned so much as a field about Parkinson's and come up with ideas about how to treat it simply from really well done observational studies. So just what's the difference? Why are we bothering to split these up? Well, the interventional studies on the left, those are the clinical trials. This is where you might sign up for a study, a clinical trial, and you'll be assigned to get perhaps a medication or perhaps placebo. you might be assigned to get surgery or sham surgery, or you might be assigned, it doesn't always have to be medical. You know, it can be that you're assigned to get on a specific exercise regimen. Like I sent patients when I was in New York from my practice, they went into a study of dance for Parkinson's and some went into a study of weight training for Parkinson's. So it doesn't have to be medicine or surgery. Or an intervention could be diet. So there are all these different types of interventions that we can study in clinical trials. Basically, if it looks like it's going to be something that's useful, it's fair game to study in a clinical trial. And there are different flavors of clinical trials. So I don't want to get too much into the weeds with this, but if you start reading about clinical trials and looking on websites, you'll see these terms of phase one, phase two, et cetera. So I have a slide in a few minutes where I just want to give a very high level overview of what are the differences between those clinical trials, because it helps you in your own mind sort out what's an early trial and what's a later phase trial where there's already a little bit more information that's available about it. That can be helpful if you're thinking about, do I want to participate or not? So these clinical trials, the bottom line, down bottom left of the table, is these are really the gold standard for studying treatments, or studying even better when we get to the point of preventing Parkinson's. And wouldn't that be amazing? And someone brought up for research, you know, research can be looking for a cure. Well, it can be, and these clinical trials are gonna be the gold standard for testing out potential cures. And then on the right-hand side of the table, let's look at the observational studies. And in these, you participate, you don't get assigned to a group, you don't get assigned to a specific intervention, you're not going to be given an experimental medicine or an experimental type of exercise and studied like that. Rather, you're going to be studied in your in the wild, if you like, in natural conditions. You're going to continue with your own regular care and your own regular activities. And there are lots of different types of observational studies. In the case control, we can compare someone, for example, a case might be someone with Parkinson's who has bad blood pressure control problems. And then the control would be someone with Parkinson's who doesn't have those problems. And it can help us to understand the differences between the two. Or a case series, for example, these are the most basic but incredibly valuable, where a researcher might say, well, look, I've seen these patients and they've got these really interesting characteristics that, or problems that no one had talked about before. Is this telling us something? And you can publish that. That would be a case series. So these can really help get information out to the field and help other researchers to think, well, have I seen that? You know, and push forward understanding of the of Parkinson's. So these observational studies are really fantastic in helping to understand Parkinson's. They can help understand associations between your health and lots of different factors, like, for example, the rate of Parkinson's progression and the type of diet that you follow. That would be an example of an observational study. So lots of really great information can come out of those types of studies. And since we're talking about observational studies, I just wanted to say there are so many of these going on. They span the globe. We've got a local study at UC Irvine run by my fantastic colleague, Dr. Nick Philippe. He's looking to see if he can develop biomarkers to diagnose patients at a very early stage of Parkinson's. And he's recording muscle activity and using magnetic stimulation of the brain. It's really fantastic technology. Across the US, there are broader efforts, and I just put an example of one of these. It's called PDBP, Parkinson Disease Biomarkers Program. That's run from the NIH, but there are many sites across the country. Basically, everyone in these sites is studying, observing people with Parkinson's, but they're also trying to take blood, for example, or take biosamples, and trying to develop biomarkers that are going to help us with diagnosis, with tracking progression of Parkinson's, and figuring out better ways of testing how people respond to different therapies. So those are the observational. And from here on out, the rest of the talk, I'm really going to focus on the clinical trials. So the clinical trials where you may be getting an intervention that's experimental. So what is a clinical trial? Clinical trials, basically a clinical research study in people to test out new treatments. And I can't emphasize this enough. No one should go into a clinical trial thinking, here's this experimental therapy. It sounds great. It's going to cure me or it's going to treat me. Because when we do the trials, it genuinely is because we don't know how well these things are going to work. We may have some idea, but we don't know for sure. We still, for the most part, got to figure out what the risks are going to be. So the clinical trials help you figure out, is a new medication or a new treatment safe? And then does it work? And then what about the side effects? Because really, if you've got something that works, but it has too many side effects, that's just not going to fly for anyone. So the clinical trials really help us to study these new medical products in people. And again, people who are considering going into these, you're not going to be a patient. This is really to test out these new interventions. So you're a subject, or better still, trial participant. I like the term partner better, actually, because that's really how it goes. Why are the clinical trials important? Well, they really unlock the door to discovery. Like I said before, you know, these are the gold standard for figuring out what are going to be new helpful treatments, new helpful interventions. And we really have to get, like I said, enough data from the clinical trials to help the FDA and other regulatory bodies in other parts of the world understand, are these treatments working well enough? Are they safe enough? And do they not have too many different side effects? So are they going to be useful? And I am so happy to see a lot of people on this call, because these trials require the participation of volunteers. So without people with Parkinson's volunteering, this is going nowhere. This is just not moving forward. And so I can't say thank you enough to people who have been involved, who are thinking about getting involved, or who suggest that other people that they know get involved. And the clinical trials just need participants from all backgrounds to participate. And again, the all backgrounds, super important. We don't just want to develop treatments that work for a particular subset of the population. For example, these treatments have to work in men and in women. So that sounds pretty basic, but it's a really important thing. Now, remember before I talked about the four phases of clinical trials. You can revisit this slide and sort of look through it and maybe look online a little bit more. But the overview is, a phase one clinical study is really going to be the earliest clinical trial. It's really looking at safety. It's not even at the point of looking at, does something work? It's looking at, is this safe? Is it kind of feasible that we can do that? And once the intervention's gone through that stage, if it's safe, you can move on. And you can start in phase two to look for side effects. And you can start to see, is this working in a smaller number of people? And it says here 100 to 300 people, but you'll find a lot of phase two studies that are actually quite a bit smaller than that. And then the phase three study, if something looks promising in phase two and looks like it's not got too many side effects, we're still looking safe, we're looking like there's a potential effect, then you can move into phase three. And phase three actually could be from hundreds, it doesn't have to be 1,000, up to thousands of people. So you can come back and look at that. There's a lot of information out on the internet about these different phases, but I wanted you to hear the terminology, because if you go on, for example, www.clinicaltrials.gov, or if you look on any clinical trials website, you're often going to be seeing something like a phase one study to investigate the effects of, or a phase three study to test whether. So that's the deal with the phases. A couple of important things to know. This is huge. You're a volunteer when you get into these studies. You should never feel like you're getting pressured. Participation in a clinical study is completely voluntary. And the way that we help to make sure that people understand and that it really is voluntary is before even performing the first activity in the study, you get an informed consent form. And I'm sorry that this should have a bullet point here, but the informed consent form, it provides a fair amount of detail about what the experimental treatment is going to be, what the visit schedule looks like, how much time you might have to spend in this trial, and any procedures that you're going to have done. Like, are you going to have a PET scan or a DAT scan, or are you going to get blood tests, or does the trial mean that you're signing up not just for the treatment, but are you signing up as well for lumbar puncture, spinal taps, and this kind of thing? So that really, the informed consent form is really a critical document. And I think it's really important that, you know, in the enthusiasm to get into the clinical trials, it's really so important just to go through what's in the informed consent and make sure you know what you're signing up for. And then sometimes when you come in and you see the teams, it may seem like people are running around and things are happening, and, you know, but it all is happening according to a really strict schedule. And the schedule is set out in what's called the study protocol. And the protocol is a written set of rules, and we as investigators, that's what we follow. So that is a really important document for us. So a little bit more about the informed consent. If you're getting into a study, you'll get the informed consent form. You're going to talk with the investigator or one of the coordinators. They can walk you through the informed consent form. Just make sure that you take enough time. And if you want to chat with a family member or a friend or whosoever, just to get advice, go ahead and ask to do that. The other thing is, this is not... it's not a kind of one-shot deal where you sign up for a study and then you don't have the right to back out. You have the right to withdraw your consent at any time. And it might be because you figure out, oh my goodness, I really can't travel that far every week to do my study visits. Or it might be that, oh my goodness, you know, someone, I'm dealing with a family emergency and I just can't do this. So we'll always try to get people through any problems that they have participating, but you have the right to withdraw. And equally, if there's new information that comes up during the trial that might affect the way you're perceiving participating in this trial, you know, that could affect whether you decide to continue or not, then the investigators really have to tell you. You really have to be provided with that additional information. So I think that I pretty well covered what's on this slide, but basically the informed consent should give you the amount of information you need to allow for an informed decision. And you just really need to make sure you understand and ask questions. And we all like this part of the process and asking, hearing the questions and working through what's going on with the trial with the potential participant. So big question, will I benefit? Do you benefit from getting into clinical trials? This isn't exactly a yes, no answer. You're not guaranteed benefit from the intervention, that's for sure. You could get benefit, but we really don't know. So this is all experimental. But being in a medical study sometimes is really great for people. They get to ask additional questions and have a fresh pair of eyes, you know, a fresh voice, a fresh face to speak with about their Parkinson's. So although no one can guarantee a direct benefit, I think a lot of people really get something out of it. Plus, there's that satisfaction of knowing that you're really contributing to what's going on in the Parkinson's field and that you're making things better for people down the line. So just checking on time, perfect. Just to go through a few potential barriers with the research. And this is based on things that people have heard as investigators for our patients. And I think a lot of these are really good questions. Clinical trials are a last resort. I think that a lot of people may feel like, you know, this is really interesting, all this experimental work, but it's not for me. You know, I'm doing fine. I'm only in my Parkinson's, my medicines are working well. And the clinical trials are for people having more problems. Well, some of the clinical trials are for people who are having more problems, but some of the clinical trials are really for anyone. So for example, a clinical trial of weight training or a clinical trial of speech therapy, or how about a clinical trial of dance for Parkinson's? So, and sometimes you'll see examples of this all over, but some of the clinical trials are really for people who are very early in the Parkinson's, even people who have just been diagnosed and haven't even started medicines yet. So there are many clinical trials that are applicable at all stages and for all types of people with Parkinson's. The second misconception is about access. And this used to be the case, I think. You needed to live near a major hospital, especially a big academic center, to be able to participate. These days, that's not so much the case. For some of the bigger trials, it can be the case. For some of the more risky advanced trials, like surgical trials, it can be the case. But there's so much research going on that is community-based these days. And I think we all realize that it's important to get out into the community and not rely on you all to have to travel into big academic centers. Another one, if I enter a clinical trial, if I get placebo, I won't be getting any benefit. Well, you keep on getting your regular clinical care, so you're really not losing anything. And once I join a trial, there's no going back. And I think this is a little bit of a scary one, but like I mentioned, there's always a way to withdraw your consent, and that has no adverse consequences for you. So a few more of these. Joining a clinical trial helps people in the future, but it doesn't help me today. Well, I think it's tremendously important to help people in the future. It's nice if it helps you today. And like I mentioned, there's so much benefit to some people for getting involved. You know, you get yourself a team who you're going to work with. You get yourself a fresh pair of eyes looking at you. And sometimes you get a little bit more of a detailed look at your Parkinson's. And sometimes that can just help you understand a little bit more what's going on with the Parkinson's and help you monitor. I don't have time to participate in a clinical trial. Okay, sometimes that's true, but seriously, speak with the research coordinators. These guys are absolutely genius at workarounds and figuring out how to get you in. We've had patients come in early in the morning or in the evening. I've had people come in on weekends. It's not always possible to do that, but sometimes we can do it. So if you're interested, but there are time barriers or scheduling barriers, just ask. There's no gain in joining a trial because I'm afraid of getting a placebo. I think we addressed that one already. And here's a big one. I get asked about this quite a bit because we all know insurance is very careful about what insurance pays for. They don't always cover experimental therapies. And so you don't want to end up out of pocket. And so you can always ask about this if you're getting involved in a clinical trial, but there's oftentimes reimbursement for travel. There can be even reimbursement for overnight stays if you're having to travel a really long way and you can't get back home. But the interventions, the experimental treatments are paid for, the tests are paid for. So getting into a clinical trial, make sure that you ask if you're worried about any particular things and the impact on your insurance, but it should not cost you out of pocket. So last few minutes, I just want to talk about the Parkinson's research at UC Irvine. And, you know, I spent the last 25 years in New York City. So March in New York City does not look like this picture. And I am incredibly happy to have come to UC Irvine, very happy to have joined the California community. And again, you know, I'm really looking forward to get to meet some of you in person when that becomes possible. So I just want to talk a little bit about our team. We have, into the striatum, that's where we feel like we belong. But I have a fantastic team of people here. And this is David Swope right now, right here, who is leading the team. Anna Marinkova, Nick Philippe, Sanaza Taripur, Alejandra Becerra Garland. These people are absolutely awesome. Every one of them is a movement fellowship trained movement disorders neurologist, all interested in Parkinson's disease. Everyone's participating in clinical research. And there's a bigger team. Our neurosurgeons are fantastic. Dr. Sue, Frank Sue, is our DBS neurosurgeon, just joined by Michelle Paff. She's right here. So very few women neurosurgeons out there, and we have one. And then we have a fantastic team of neuropsychologists who help us with all the memory testing that we do in the trials, for example. So this team is headed by Mark Mapstone, but we have Katie Denny and Haley Christensen and Tim O'Brien. And Tim does most of our clinical neuropsychology, but the others are all involved in our Parkinson's research. And here's a team. Our staff, our students, is photograph taken pre-COVID when we didn't have to distance and mask. These are the people that are on the ground. These are the people that make all the research happen. And I just wanted to show you the facilities that we have. So this is where the research coordinators live. This building right up here is where I live, and that's where a lot of our patients are seen for the clinical trials. In what we call the ICTS, which is a kind of dedicated unit for clinical trials. And then we're lucky enough to have this stem cell, alpha stem cell clinic and stem cell institute right here in the Sue and Bill Gross Hall. It's a CIRM institute. And Daniela Botta, who's in my department, is head of neuro-oncology. She is also director of our stem cell clinic. So we have some fantastic people there and fantastic capabilities. So just very, very quickly in the next few minutes, talk to you about some of the studies that we're interested in. This is a study of Nick Philippe, and it's run in a really fantastic clinical trials network called NeuroNext, and they're coming out of the NIH. It's a national network, and there are just over 20 different centers, and Nick got chosen. It's very competitive. Nick got chosen to help them run this study of this very innovative light therapy for impaired sleep in Parkinson's disease. And I know in Parkinson's, you know, so many of my patients, I would think the vast majority actually have some problem or another with their Parkinson's, with their sleep due to their Parkinson's disease. And here's Dr. Swope, our head of movement disorders, and my own Kitty here, Penelope, both showing how it's done. And unfortunately, that's not how sleep happens in Parkinson's. So we very definitely need better therapies. And I love the idea of testing something that is not a medication. However, coming to medications, Dr. Anna Marinkova, she's our site investigator for a study of something called NLY01. There's a catchy name that trips right off the tongue. But in fact, it's related to a drug that is a diabetes drug. And this type of drug has been looked at for a while as a potential neuroprotectant for Parkinson's disease. I just wanted to bring up, it is a kind of small world. What is thought is that these drugs may have an effect on immune cells in the brain, and they may help to tone down inflammation that's seen in the brain. And this is sort of a shameless self-promotion for my group back in New York, who I left behind. But we had been looking a few years ago at how we could do brain scans and look at inflammation in Parkinson's disease. And this is one of the more extreme examples, but this is someone who does not have Parkinson's. And you'll see there's very little signal right here. This is someone who has Parkinson's, and this green signal right here. These are areas of inflammation. So it's really great after our early research in that to see a company come along and start to address this type of process in Parkinson's and try to slow down the progression. At the other end of the scale, Anna is also looking at a drug that she hopes is going to help people improve their balance with Parkinson's disease. And for anyone who's got problems with falling and balance, I just put up this link here, Stall the Fall, from the Parkinson Foundation, because this is just, it's so hard, and we just don't have great medications to help with balance at this point. Related to balance, if you fall, you're at risk of fracture. So Nick Philippe is collaborating with the UCSF team. We love our collaborators, and he's part of the TOPAS study for prevention of fractures in Parkinson's disease. And then last couple of minutes, I just wanted to mention some surgical clinical trials. And these photos are courtesy of Dr. Vivian Tabar, who is the lead surgeon on a study that I'm going to mention in a minute. So she's back in New York, but we're going to be participating from UC Irvine. Dr. Philippe has been working on a gene therapy study. He's leading us as one of the sites for infusion of GDNF, which we hope is going to be a protectant. Dr. Marinkova is leading at our site. It's a multi-site investigation of gene therapy to help boost dopamine in people with more advanced Parkinson's. So what I wanted to spend the last 2 minutes on is stem cell therapy. So I've been involved in gene therapy before, but the main thrust of my own research has been stem cell therapy. Well, why and how are we going to do it? Well, we know in Parkinson's disease that there's this tiny little area of the brain called the substantia nigra. That's where there's an intense concentration of dopamine cells, about 500,000 per side, 500,000 on the left, 500,000 on the right for the substantia nigra. These are the cells that are damaged. They don't release as much dopamine as they should. And, that's what causes a lot of the movement problems in Parkinson's. So we did, it's possible to do a thought experiment and think about, well, how many cells do you need to replace to relieve symptoms? And it turns out it's not that many, actually. It's a little bit over 100,000, we think. And the idea is, can we take cells that are going to release dopamine and transplant them into these deep areas of the brain where the dopamine is, where you don't have enough dopamine in Parkinson's disease? And several years ago, Lorenz Studer, who's in New York, and Vivian Tabar, who's in New York, she's a surgeon, figured out how they could take stem cells and really coax them in a dish to turn into dopamine producing cells. And they then went on to do some preclinical experiments in rodents to show that these cells could be transplanted. And in animal models of Parkinson's, that these cells would actually relieve the symptoms. So the idea is, well, could we very cautiously try this in humans? Well, it's been about 10 years, I would say, maybe a little bit more, that I was working as the clinical arm for Lorenz and Vivian's team. And we are just about to start a phase one study. Remember, phase one, it's when you're testing safety, looking at safety and looking at the side effects of transplanting these cells surgically into both sides of people's brain, into the area where dopamine is lost. So it's a surgical transplantation. So it's an aggressive intervention, but it's the infusion is done with our patients under general anesthesia. It's for people with more advanced Parkinson's. And these cells are not immunologically matched. This is like a sort of off the shelf, one size fits all. That's how we were thinking of it. And so people are going to get a year of immunosuppression. So you can imagine we're going to be watching these people like hawks to see what the side effects are going to look like. And we're not the only team who are doing this. You probably know that in Japan, back in 2018, they reported that they had implanted reprogrammed stem cells into a patient with Parkinson's disease. These are a different sort of cell, but they were not the man's own cells. I was part of the team in New York that was led by the main team up at Massachusetts General Hospital and Harvard, where we did implant someone's own dopamine, like juvenile dopamine cells, to see if it would help his Parkinson's. This was a single person, it's open label, so we can't really tell too much about is this something that is really going to work across the board, but it was a fantastic first step. The surgery went really well and was really well tolerated. And then there are some efforts, and I just wanted to mentioned that people across the world are really coming together now to share data, share best practices. And this was a group of us who went out to visit the researchers in Japan, in Kyoto, who were performing these transplants that I mentioned before. And you may see some people on the photo that you know. So I'll finish right there. And I do want to say thank you all. Special thanks to the Parkinson's Foundation for their awesome work, and an even bigger thanks to all of you, because like I mentioned, if we don't get volunteers with Parkinson's for the clinical studies, then none of this is going to fly. We're not going to make progress. So it's really down to all of you and your participation. So thank you so much. And I'll finish right there. Thanks.
Thank you so much. What an informative presentation. I have lots of notes and we have lots of questions. So keep those questions coming. We are going to have a Q&A segment at the very end. Right now we have a very special treat for you. Lisbeth Garces has joined us to do a dance break. So Lisbeth, we're going to spotlight you, bring you on here, and everybody join in, keep those questions coming, and we'll see you in a few minutes.
Hola. I'm just going to do a little demonstration on, you know, doing some dancing. I'm very glad to be here. Thank you for inviting me, and I hope you enjoy. I have my Latin background, so I'm going to do some Latin and some a little bit of different music. So if you're sitting in a chair, you can move your arms and move your legs however you can, all right? So I hope you enjoy. Okay, we have a little salsa here, so we're gonna go to the side, right, left. Yes, just dancing that way. Out, out. Can you hear the music okay? Bring your arms to the side to side. Now try the clock 3 times, right? 1, 2, 3. We're going to do it again. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Again. Now we're just going to move your shoulders. Up, up, shoulders. Now we're gonna bring it back. Bring your arms back. Get the hips, come on. To me. Your shoulders. Now we're going to go to the side, ready? 1, 2, 3. Now we're going to clap 3 times.
Clap. Voy a escuchar el silencio para encontrar el camino. ¿Para qué llorar? ¿Para qué? Si muere una vida, ¿y para qué sufrir? ¿Para qué? Si muere una vida, se olvida.
¿Y para qué? ¿Y para qué? Back. Yeah. Now we're going to go forward back. Forward, center, back. Forward.
I can't handle it.
this thing alone. In a cradle of its wings, and it jives, it shakes all over like a jellyfish. Kinda like it. There's a thing called love.
Quiero que me levante hasta perder la razón. soy son, caballo, boca y sombrero, tequila, tabaco, ron, la mora, la mexicana, caliente al ritmo del sol, despacio y luego me mata, un macho de corazón, la mora, la mexicana, que nunca va dando el sol, caballo, boca y sombrero, tequila, tabaco, ron.
So we can close with that.
That was time. I'm sorry. We wish we had more time. Nobody ever wants to stop dancing when Lisbeth is on. I know. I have to pull everyone away from it. Thank you. I wanted to mention Lisbeth is actually the founder of the Juan Carlos organization, and she was one of the first Zumba instructors in San Diego. So she's built this regular following because she's really fun, and she does all these really fun Latin inspired dance classes for people of all abilities, including Parkinson's. She's also a Parkinson's support group leader. She does a Spanish class online. So there, her information is in the chat, and I encourage you all to reach out to her and learn more. Thank you, Lisbeth.
Thank you.
Okay, we're excited to introduce now Dr. Irene Litvin. Dr. Litvin is a board-certified neurologist and director of the Parkinson's and Other Movement Disorder Center at UC San Diego Health, a Parkinson's Foundation Center of Excellence. Additionally, Dr. Litvin is the Tash Endowed Professor in Parkinson's Disease Research at UC San Diego School of Medicine. Welcome, Dr. Litvin.
Thank you very much. It is an honor. It is a pleasure to be with all of you. I really thank the Parkinson's Foundation for doing this phenomenal symposium. So I do also thank all the other participants, including you, all of you, as well as those that are the speakers and dancers. I love to see so many people dancing. Wow. Okay, so I was asked to talk about what's new in Parkinson's disease research at UCSD. So during this talk, I will answer a few questions about research and give you some examples of current PD research studies that are occurring at UCSD. As Dr. Henschliff stated, there are observational studies in which we discover without any intervention to understand the causes, the risk, finding biomarkers to diagnose the diseases. There are translational studies in which we turn basic signs or observations to the clinic or from the clinic to the community. And the idea is to improve health. And there are therapeutic trials in which we investigate whether a treatment under investigation improves participants' health. So I'll discuss a few examples of all of them. But before asking and talking about that, I will go over again over why research participation is important in Parkinson's. And I think that David will follow David Higgins and will go more in depth. But basically, is the only way that we can advance knowledge about the causes, identify novel treatments, biomarkers to early diagnose, or measure treatment successes. So if we don't know anything, is because at times there is no technology, but at times it's also lack of participation. So it is a great unmet need. And without participation in research, certainly research cannot advance. So why diversity? Why is it that at times studies are requiring, and NIH is requiring, diversity in research? Well, diverse populations may have different genes involved, different risk factors. The progression may be different in different populations. The treatments may not have the same benefits or side effects. And of course, we want to help everyone. So there are multiple reasons, but biological ones, the disease may go faster and we want to know what are the genes involved or what is the cause that makes it go faster or slower. Why studying or participating in biomarkers research? To help identify markers to diagnose a disease accurately and earlier. As you know, currently we diagnose diseases based on our clinical questionnaires and examinations, a timeline that is extremely important. But if we had a marker like glucose, for example, for diabetes, that would make it so much easier. Markers also help us measure if an intervention is successful. At times we use a test, but the test may not be as sensitive or as good or as important as a biomarker that we find. And we also want to know the natural history of the disease. So we want to know how people evolve with time, and that is a way to do so. So who should participate in these studies? Well, it depends. It could be persons with Parkinson's, those without Parkinson's, because we want to compare the populations, or those who have or don't have whatever it is that we're going to study. It's cognitive problems, it's anxiety, whatever. Why searching for genetic mutations? Well, we want to identify genes that can help us understand the pathways that causes a disease. Why is it that this person has this disease and has a gene? And as we know about this gene, that's how actually we learn about alpha-synuclein, the protein that is a major protein that is aggregated that doesn't function well in Parkinson's disease, is because we identify a family that had this kind of mutation in Greece. To early diagnose and treat patients carrying that specific mutations. So we want to diagnose them as early as possible. Let's say we do find a treatment that can cure, slow the disease. We will never recover cells that are dead, but we can stop the disease at that particular moment. And if we diagnose them before the symptoms occur, of course, we are much better off. We want to know the frequency of the mutation, and we want to focus, for example, research in those that may be more common, or put the efforts in particular genes. The PD gene is a beautiful example of how people can participate and study the older genes that are at this present known in Parkinson's disease. This allows the persons who now know that they have a mutation to participate in therapeutic studies to slow the progression of the disease, targeting those specific mechanism. And so that's why some people that had the PD gene study were able to study in studies to slow disease progression in a mutation called GBA. So as we say, there could be only a single gene that causes a disease, or there could be multiple genes that can modify the course of the illness. And we want to know them all because we want to find the proper treatment for a specific person to make it a personalized therapeutics. So this person may have a different gene than the other one and may benefit from a different treatment than this other person. We also want to prevent the illness. So if we know about environmental exposures, occupational exposures, et cetera, we can try to see that we can prevent people, particularly those that have specific genes that may make this even worse, to do work on with pesticides, or they need to cover in a very specific way. Everybody should cover themselves, but perhaps this should be even more intense. So what observational studies we have? I did talk about the PD gene that is mapping the future of Parkinson's. We just finished a study, ROPAD, that did the same, but also went a little bit beyond that and study the genes in more detail. And we have several biomarker studies and natural history study. We have POP that we had it for Hispanics. We have it for Hispanics now, was for everybody before, but now because there have been very few Hispanics, that is where and our population in our area could have more Hispanics. That's why we're doing this particular focus. We want to study and search for biomarkers in dementia with Lewy bodies. That's extremely important because it is a difficult disease to diagnose and it's important for prognosis. We have studies with several other diseases that have a different protein deposited into the brain, such as progressive supranuclear palsy and corticobasal degeneration or frontotemporal dementia, that have tau as a specific protein that deposits in the brain and also cause a different Parkinsonian disorder. So people may ask, why would you do a research in different stage? And why don't you get me into the study? And the question is that the studies are trying to treat the earliest as possible someone. So if we were to be able to treat people at the preclinical level before they have any symptoms, and we just know the genetic factors, or we know that they have an abnormal imaging, that would be the best, right? No symptoms, no nothing, that will not move from that. Or we can have it before the motor symptoms, what is called the prodromal phase. And there we have some of the predictors of Parkinson's, but we don't truly have a diagnosis of Parkinson's. And when do we have it? When we have the Parkinsonian features, the slowness, stiffness, or tremor that associates with the slowness. So we do want then as well to avoid complications. We also want to treat people that have already complications because the disease has advanced more and they may have dyskinesias, they may have cognitive problems, they may have problems with the autonomic system, that is blood pressure that drops significantly, orthostatic hypotension when someone stands up, or that do have other problems such urinary problems. So let me go back to the thing about the treatment and how could we do things much better than what we're doing them now. So we are unable to measure the concentrations of levodopa in the blood now, but we do know that is what we call the therapeutic window. So what is that? Well, if this is the amount of levodopa that someone gets that is pulsatile because it doesn't last too long in the blood, then we have a minimal amount that is needed in order to get benefit. That is what is called the efficacy threshold. And then even if we give a lot of medication, it is hard to get to the dyskinesia threshold when the symptoms occur because there are a stimulation or overstimulation of some neurons. Then we come to a stage in which this window becomes smaller and is moderate. So we have to use more medication and we are at risk of getting to dyskinesias. And as the disease advances, this window gets narrow and narrow, and it comes to a point that is very difficult to get to the proper amount of medication. If we were to know what kind of, how much we would use, we would try to use a minimal amount that we can early on. And obviously we would try to get to the actual therapeutic window of the specific person that is different than the other person. So we talked about fluctuations and I said dyskinesias, but there are also other fluctuations that are non-motor. For example, anxiety, drenching sweats. And for some people, these are much worse problems than the motor symptoms. So nowadays, what do we have? Well, when we try to tell someone, okay, so tell us when you're on, when you're not having the symptoms that are bothering you and you're doing well with your levodopa, tell me when you're stiff, tell me when you have anxiety, et cetera, et cetera. And they have to kind of put it every half an hour and try to tell us, or when they were asleep or were just in bed doing nothing, so there's no movement, et cetera. But what if we can measure those levels of levodopa? And that's kind of what we're trying to do. And this is translational research. That is, from bioengineers that are helping us, we're trying to develop this sensor that is very tiny. You can see this is a finger and this is the sensor. That would communicate with a phone and would give us the exact amount of levodopa. And this would be measured by very tiny, tiny ways that actually are not painful at all. And there are two different ways of measuring it, by either the enzymes or by a different story that is voltammetric, but it doesn't really matter. So this is kind of how the integrated sensor looks like. And these are the tiny little, I lost the word, but anyway, what it goes into the skin, it doesn't really go beyond that. Because it tries to get to the interstitial fluid where there are no vessels and there are no nerves, so it doesn't hurt, but it still measures the levodopa. There are other things. There was a talk about studies for falls. The issue is that people get to the emergency room and when people say, well, why did you fall? And they say, I have no idea. At times they can identify there was a problem and it was an accident, but at times they don't realize that they were freezing or there is a severe drop of the blood pressure or they have palpitations and there is an arrhythmia or they have a seizure. So the idea for us is, okay, let's find all these causes that are the most common ones and then also get the symptoms of the person. If they are near falls, if they're falling, if they're feeling that fainting, et cetera. So we develop this software that basically measure all these things that we ask. And so someone can press and basically is guided to answer questions that would allow us to understand what happened at that time. Whereas at the same time, the person wears very unobstructive sensors that basically measure the things that we just mentioned, blood pressures, you know, electroencephalogram, heart, et cetera, as well as walking. And then we can have the electrocardiogram, and we have all the recording of the gait, et cetera. And we put all that together and we're giving it to either the patient, the physician, whatever, so people can help themselves to understand A, how they failed, and B, can they prevent it? And that is the other part that we're developing as well. Can we prevent those falls if we know the cause? So I mentioned two different studies that are translationals. We have more than that. And we have this other one that is trying to find another sensor to measure continuously the blood pressure that we will use as well for the study. So Dr. Hentschiff did talk about the different phases of drug development. And so there is an initial part in which, you know, this is kind of based on observations. There is where it comes the idea of doing a specific trial, and there is a testing in animals to try to see the safety and to try to see if it works. And then it goes into the different phases that she clearly explained. What happens here is that the cost is huge. To get a drug into the market takes $2.6 million. May take 13 to 15 years, and only 11% enter into the market. So that's why we don't have many more than what we have. So there are different types of therapies. Some of them go to the symptoms, and some of them are for slowing disease progression. These ones are open to enrollment, so people can participate. And one of them is to use subcutaneous levodopa delivery that is being compared to oral delivery in patients that do have Parkinson's and fluctuations that have at least 2 hours of periods on average. Then there is this other study that is to try to treat people that have orthostatic hypotension. And that could be due to multiple diseases, including Parkinson's, multisystem atrophy, et cetera. So people say, so why am I to go into a placebo? Why is it that that happens to me? And why is it that I'm gonna have to do that? Well, that's the only way for us to determine whether an intervention is better than the natural history. This is a way in which we can say, oh, wait, there are many more problems in this population that is getting the drug, so let's stop this trial. It's not beneficial. Or we can say these complications, let's say falls, are part of the illness, are unrelated to the intervention we want to measure. So it is important to have placebos, because eventually, at the end of the placebo phase, you go into the phase that is the open phase in which you actually get the real drug in general. So we want to prevent diseases, we want to slow them, we want to halt them. And that's exactly what we want to do with Parkinson's disease. So there are many strategies, and reducing the oxidative damage or inflammation, that is one measure that has been tried and continues to be tried. There is also promoting the support of the neurons, like nerve growth factors, for example. It is also to target abnormal proteins. We don't want them to be produced, so can we work on the translation from DNA to RNA, the messenger, or to before the RNA messenger, before the proteins are developed? Can we destroy that abnormal protein, et cetera? And can we avoid the spread of the illness? So we're trying to do all those things with different studies. These ones are coming up. They are in the phase in which we are finishing up all the paperwork at the university. And one of them is the nerve growth factors for people that have MSA with Parkinsonism. Another study is to use antisense oligonucleotides in patients with Parkinson's disease. This one is to try to see that we can avoid the development of these abnormal proteins. There is this early phase of the prasinezumab that has been already tried in patients with early Parkinson's without any treatment. Now this study accepts people that are on levodopa or they are on Azilect or something similar, MAO inhibitor, that are stable for 6 months on the treatment, and is trying to see whether these antibodies can spread the disease. We can stop the spread of the disease. So it's like the antibody gets binding to the abnormal protein and tries to kind of clean the system of these abnormal proteins. And now we're getting a trial that we were just told about, a small molecule. This one is oral for people that are not treated with Parkinson's disease. And this is a phase one study, 1B, that is normal people have gone through it and there are no side effects to be able to go into patients. Overall then, we want personalized medicine. We want to know the genes so we can, we don't want to know the risk factors so we can really try to personalize the treatment of every person. We want to know how much levodopa you need. We want to know things that would help us try to improve the health, but in a more direct way. This is our group that is constituted for several movement disorder specialists, neurosurgeons. We have several fellows. We have as well coordinators, neuropsychologists, rehab, PT, OT. We do have as well social workers, et cetera. So we meet actually on a weekly basis to discuss patients that may not be doing well or may need special management or may go into studies that may be more invasive or to surgical treatments. So thank you. If you need any help, just call us. Actually, Ashwarya Nerula, you may have seen in the other slides, is the person that is our coordinator and will be happy to answer any questions. You can communicate through the website as well. These studies are explained in more detail, and we can certainly explain them to you and send you the consent form that is extremely important that you read in detail and then discuss with us. So thank you so much, all of you, for your attention, for coming here. And this is it. So let me stop sharing.
Thank you so much. So Dr. Litvin, I think we'll go ahead and introduce David, unless you would like to introduce him.
Well, David, for me, doesn't require any introduction. He is an incredible advocate for Parkinson's disease. I know very little amount of people that would have stopped their scientific careers to dedicate themselves to Parkinson's disease, to try to work on seeing if genes are relevant, if stem cells are relevant, if any treatments are relevant. And incredibly, he has developed 9 support groups in our area. So he single-handedly with his partner, these support groups that, as you can imagine, require a lot of attention. But he started with one, and it kind of mushroomed in all these support groups. And we're very, very happy to have him collaborating and working with us at UCSD. So welcome, David, and thank you ahead of time for all you do.
Hey. Thank you, Dr. Litvan. I think I should just pack up and go home. I don't think I have anything to add to that. No, seriously. It's a pleasure and an honor to follow in your footsteps, Dr. Litvan. I appreciate everything that you do for us. And it is it has been a drop in the bucket for us to support you. What I'd like to do is to sort of set the stage. I'm going to have a little bit of a mishmash of a talk, and then I'm going to try to make an argument for bringing support groups into your life if you don't already have them there, and how that can actually support what you just heard from Dr. Litvan very, very critically. But to start that, I'd like to reframe where your head is right now. Wonderful talk by Dr. Litvan with lots of resources and what's going on in the field. And let me tell you, put that into a personal perspective. And I'd like to do that with the following. So listen carefully. As a person with Parkinson's disease, I get up every morning thinking about it. Not because I choose to, but because I have to. Parkinson's disease is with me all day, every day. People who do Parkinson's research get up every morning thinking about it too. Not because they have to, but because they choose to. Parkinson's disease is with them all day, every day. So those are the people that we want to support. Next slide. A little bit about me. I was born and raised in West Virginia. Got a PhD at the University of Rochester in upstate New York, a postdoc at NIH, and I've been in the biotech community for some years after that. I was diagnosed with Parkinson's in December of 2011, and I like to brag and embarrass her that I was Dr. Litvan's first patient on her first day at UCSD. So that's an honor that no one can take away from me. So I have a pretty interesting history of family history of PD. My mother had PD, my uncle, great uncle, and my grandmother. So. And as she pointed out, I'm coordinating UCSD's Parkinson's Support Group Network, where she has been absolutely pivotal in our success. So I'd like to thank her for that, actually. And next slide. So why am I talking about support groups when this is supposed to be talking about research? We came up with a name for a support group that maybe helps draw that connection. We're saying that support groups are sort of post-clinic care. If you think of the clinic as your diagnosis, your evaluation, finding out a drug regimen that works for you, getting into a rhythm that turns you back into a human being. I would be as bold as saying that before and after I met Dr. Litvan, I went from being a thing to being a human being again. That's the magic of medicine and the magic of the practitioner of medicine. So support groups are a post-clinic care. It's after you've got everything lined up, and this is a place to keep everything going and meet other people, compare notes, take those back to Dr. Litvan or whoever you see and ask her, so what do you think about this? They will gladly tell you what they think about that. So there's a connection between the clinic and the real world, if you will. Support groups are a great place to learn about clinical trials. And we do that every month. We have someone come from UCSD and give us an update on what trials are available, what the needs are. And it's an incredible circle or back and forth, whatever you want to call it. So next slide. So what is a support group? This is a lot of information on this slide, but I'll go over it quickly. It's peer-to-peer sharing experiences. It's what living with PD and managing PD is like. It's interactions with your physician, your neurologist. We don't practice medicine. We share the practice of medicine. We talk about physicians and clinical trials and drugs and things that work and things that don't. So and then there's a component of education. We try to instill in our support group members information, knowledge, vocabulary, confidence, so that when they go talk to their physician, they can do so with confidence and with authority and with some knowledge, so that their interaction is fruitful. And of course, emotional support. So you're surrounded by people who get it. Some people's idea of the worst day of their life is to be in a room full of people who are sick, who have a terminal disease, or have something that's completely debilitating. I can assure you, if you come to one of our support group meetings, you will be inspired, not put off. I give you my word at that. So we're gonna do something just kind of for fun, because we got a pretty big crowd here. So stick to your computer, and we're gonna take a poll. We're gonna ask you a couple questions. We're gonna use some Zoom technology. You know, we're all obsessed with Zoom these days. But we're trying to tell you or teach you how this can be used in a productive way. So in a moment, we're gonna start the poll. And so there'll be some brief instructions. We'll get the results live within just a couple of seconds. We have a limited time to focus on the results. And then we'll go on from there and see where the next one takes us. So go to your screen. Go ahead and start the poll. So here's the question. Have you ever participated in a Parkinson's related clinical trial? This should be a yes or no. And we'll give it a few seconds and they'll tell us when all the voting is completed. Danielle, you give us the word when to stop.
Yep, we'll give it a few more seconds.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Poll is closed. So yes, 23%. I'm gonna write that down. And no, so 77%, so there's only two questions. Great, okay, so we've got a lot of work to do here, Dr. Levin. Okay, everybody got that. So about one quarter, three quarters, roughly speaking. So we can do better than that, and the Parkinson's research community needs us to do better than that. Okay, let's go on to the next slide.
Okay.
We'll hang on to that question for you.
Okay, so we're gonna...
Okay, there we go. If you get rid of that.
So we're done with that. Stop here.
Okay.
Oops.
No, I'm there. There we go. Top left. We're still learning how to do this. Okay, so you heard reference earlier about motor symptoms and non-motor symptoms, and you all know this. Motor symptoms are sort of the historical perfect measurement of what Parkinson's means, and there's tremors is the sort of canonical symptom, slowness, stiffness, balance, gait, freezing, dyskinesia, all the things that you know about. And you, probably more so than the medical community, understand the non-motor symptoms are a big part of your life. Dr. Littman is actually an exception to most neurologists. She gets it exactly right. She understands it, and as does her staff. That's not typical, so just keep that in mind. But non-motor symptoms include fatigue, anxiety, insomnia, sleep disorders, cognitive impairment, constipation, orthostatic hypotension, hallucinations, delusions, and red noses or something like that. You name it, we can get it. So here's the second poll. Cue up for the second poll. Limited to just this list, the list that you have in front of you. If you don't have it, let us know. There's a list of eight things: tremor, slowness, stiffness, balance, gait, freezing, dyskinesia. These are motor symptoms. And which one of these has the greatest impact on your day-to-day life? Just from this list here, pick one and record your entry. Okay, can everybody see this? Is this in real time, Danielle?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Let's give folks a few more seconds to fill it out.
Good. So a third say tremor, 17% say slowness, stiffness 14, balance 17, 8, 6, and 6. I apologize if maybe there's something that a motor symptom that you have that's not on here. So I, if we were doing this for real, we'd be more careful about that. But don't worry about that for now. This is mostly to show you the process that we can go through to come up with an important conclusion. Okay, Daniel, move on anytime you're ready. We're gonna go to poll number 3. See, they give us Zoom. What are you supposed to do? If you're in a pandemic and you're stuck in your house for a year and you've got Zoom, what do? You're gonna figure out how to do something fun with it. So we haven't figured out how to play chess with it yet, but we're working on that. So number 3, limited to this list again on the screen, which of these non-motor symptoms has the greatest impact on your day-to-day life? Choose one. Okay, go for it. Okay, interesting. Wow, this is very interesting. I have to say I'm surprised at this. This is really interesting information. This is a large enough group for it to be meaningful. Okay, are we done, Danielle?
Yes.
Okay, now go to the fourth poll, please. The fourth and last one. This is where we get a little bit tricky. So considering only the two symptoms you chose in the last two polls, what your motor symptom was that you chose as the most significant one, and what your non-motor symptom was that was the most significant. Between those two, which one of them had the biggest negative impact on your day? Oh, well, look at that. So, okay, good. Oh, this is fun. This is really fun. Okay, everybody looking at the results. There we go. Poll's closed. So, wow, look at that. So motor symptom is 55% and the other is 45. So what does that tell us? Wow, I have to say I'm a little bit surprised. So that's good. Being surprised is good. So let's go to the next slide and we'll summarize and talk about it. So what have we learned? And what does it matter? So we've learned, 45, 55, realistically, statistically, that's probably a pretty similar number. So about half of you are more impacted by your motor skills than your motor symptoms than you are your non-motor symptoms. But the reason we did it in the way we did and didn't just come out and ask you about motor symptoms and non-motor symptoms is because we tricked you. We tricked you into picking the most important one from both of those categories so that you couldn't pick two from one category. So we truly drilled down to your favorite disability, not the one that you had two and you had to choose both of them. So this is a little example of how polls can be used, not to manipulate your thinking, but to manipulate getting an honest answer out of you. And it's absolutely fascinating. So it gives us a snapshot of what Parkinson's symptoms have the biggest impact on the quality of our lives. So how can we use that information to influence research and development of new drugs? What does this have to do with anything? Next one. did you poll generally that you found that your motor symptoms or your non-motor symptoms were most impactful? The non-motor symptoms can be even more debilitating than the stereotypical motor symptoms, but you understand that. And non-motor symptoms include everything but the kitchen sink. If I get up in the morning and my big toe hurts, I say, it's probably Parkinson's. Everything. And I think most of us have had probably everything on this list at some time or another. If it weren't so serious, it'd be comical. Like Dr. Littman likes to say, this is a boutique disease. You get to choose your favorite item off the shelf, and chances are you'll be covered. So we need more better drugs. This is what you heard from both the speakers. We need more better drugs to treat a broader number of symptoms other than just what levodopa does. So next slide. If you don't already know this, you should know this and you should be impressed. Levodopa is the most common ingredient for drugs with Parkinson's disease, and it has been around for over 50 years. My grandmother who had Parkinson's, was in a trial in 1968. And so I remember very vividly her before, and even though I was a young kid, her before and after treatment with levodopa, and it was remarkable. I am privileged to have that memory. So the only thing that's changed about the use of levodopa in that period of time is delivery. So time released, Rotari has maybe better time release, and you can get it through a port into your stomach. You can now take it through a breathalyzer, Inbrija type thing. There's developing an under the tongue absorption. I mean, there's everything. And what's hot, so to speak, that you heard from the previous two speakers are drugs that target specific new drug targets that are more effective. Personalized medicine that Dr. Litvan mentioned, that a drug can be, or a therapy can be designed specifically for you. Stem cells, biomarkers, critical biomarkers. They're not sexy, but absolutely critical. Identifying the genes that are involved, and identifying for real what the environmental factors are. And a whole other story. But so why are we here? We've got data to show you that what you're bothered by, and that can be fleshed out. We've got physicians telling us that we need volunteers to do new clinical trials to explore these new areas. And I bring you support groups as a place where you can go to learn about that and be encouraged to do that and actually make that happen for the community. So it's a new world. At UCSD, patients are being invited to work with movement disorder specialists to help identify new therapies and address directly Parkinson's patients' needs. Dr. Litvan and her crew, and others as well, of course, are coming to patients saying, I need you to help me design this drug or design this therapy. Tell me what's important. I can share with you what we can do. Let's do this together. But how do those physicians know what the needs of the patient are unless they ask? And if we don't tell, it's just a double closed loop. So the don't ask, don't tell policy, as it were, didn't work very well for the military in the 1990s. And I don't think it's gonna work very well for drug development. So we need to share information. We need to talk. We need to meet. We need to respect. We need to pick brains. Next slide. Physicians understand the need and the value of having patients involved. Can you imagine a car company designing and manufacturing a vehicle without consumer input? Can you imagine that? The most important and transformative innovations in both of these examples would never have been made without the medical industry looking for new therapies, or the car industry listening to customers and what they want. And here's an example. Anybody remember the Pinto from the 70s? Great example of a car that had no connection to what consumers wanted. And then on the other extreme, the Tesla, the car that everybody's talking about and everybody's gonna buy. We're all gonna be driving Teslas in a few years, I'm sure. But how it's changed, because Tesla asked customers what they wanted, and so they can't sell them fast enough. So cars and medicine are a strange bedfellow, but you get the point. So I would go back to our initial slide and then say that, and remind you that research, new drugs, new approaches, patient-physician collaboration, it's all a reminder of why we're here. And we're here for different reasons and with different skills and different expertise, but we're all here to support each other, either as a patient supporting researchers who will have breakthrough therapies, or as a physician lobbying for therapies for our patients. Shouldn't we help them? Remember that what you do matters. Next slide, I think it's the last one. If you still have questions, join a support group, ask a question, make a new friend. You're not alone. And with that, I'll stop.
Thank you so much, David. I really appreciate that. We had lots of comments coming through the chat expressing people's appreciation for your presentation. So I'm gonna invite Dr. Litvin, Dr. Hinchcliffe on screen with me here. And we're gonna do our Q&A. So let's see. We have a lot of good questions. So I'm going to start with Dr. Hinchcliffe. We heard that there are a lot of people that can be involved in a study. We have the center and we have the doctors and the people with Parkinson's. Sometimes we have pharma companies, wearables. So there's a lot of people involved. Some informed consent forms might allow my information and biological materials to be shared with others. And the concern is that sometimes it's unrelated to research projects. So this person wants to know, how can we be sure and how do we know exactly where our information goes?
Yeah, that's a really great question, actually. And you never want to think about, you know, releasing your own information by signing an informed consent, thinking that, you know, you're doing the best for the research community, and then discovering that, well, maybe, you know, your samples have been sold, or, you know, your information has been released and it's been being used for non-Parkinson's research or research that you wouldn't agree with. So I would say when you sign off on the informed consent, ask. Because even if the level of detail that you want is not on the informed consent, the investigators either will know that or they can find out for you. It's super important. And I think that's, you know, we all want our patients and our participants to feel comfortable and confident in us when we do these studies.
Thank you. The next question is for Dr. Litvin. We heard you say longitudinal study a few times, and we just wanted to clarify, what is a longitudinal study and how is it different from other types of studies?
So there are two types of studies, let's say. One that looks just at the present time and doesn't follow patients forward. Those are what we call cross-sectional. You don't have to remember this word. The other ones are longitudinal, that is, we follow the patients several times for several visits up to a certain point, either due to funding, either because the outcome has been finished or the timeline is finished. For example, all the clinical trials are longitudinal, follow someone prospectively.
Great, thank you for clarifying that. We hear a lot about this recently with the COVID studies, right? We've been hearing, so I think people have this more top of mind, which is good. The next question is for Dr. Higgins. We had a comment just, you know, wanting to know, what do you think is, what are some keys to living well with Parkinson's besides the support group? What would be your advice for people with Parkinson's living well?
Sorry, I was on mute. Exercise is a universal recommendation. But going back to support groups, I think one of the things that support groups can provide, I've witnessed it, is new friends, social interactions. And don't let things like deadly viruses and quarantine at home stop you. You've got to figure out ways, like using Zoom is what we did, figure out ways to communicate, to interact, to assure people that there's life after COVID. So that was a need that just thrown in our face. And I think we came through, the parts of the community came through it incredibly well. So exercise, of course. Dr. Litvin would give you a long list of things to do as well. And I would add social interaction. Don't let go of social interaction. I just heard yesterday on the news that the average weight gain for an American in the past year was 2 pounds per month.
Okay, that's motivation to get moving, I would say. Okay. Elizabeth, actually, do you mind, we want to spotlight you, and Elizabeth, do you mind letting people sort of just know what, where you are and what you do? I know talking about that exercise, that dance is so fun. Can you tell us about that?
Of course, yes. I think that exercise is the best way to do all those things that they were saying. You know, you're socialized. I have classes on Zoom where people, even though in this time, I mean, I have been, haven't been in person for about a year, but you know, socializing and dancing, exercise, I also do boxing. I think the combination of all that, I have students, they're doing my boxing classes that said, well, you know, I was walking every day, and but when I do the class with you, oh my God, I'm so exhausted. I'm just, you know, I feel like my whole body's working. Normally when you walk, you know, unless you're walking with your arms up and down, you're just walking. But exercising, I think, is the best. I had my mother with Parkinson's, and, you know, I wish I would know what I know now when she was alive. And because it's just exercise, it's so important. And, you know, good eating and always keep social life. And, you know, I hear a lot of people with Parkinson's now that I'm actually more in contact because I have a support group. And they are like, you know, one of the questions is that, are you like afraid to talk to people? Don't be, you know, like they would say, you know, you have to be like anybody else. You can't let Parkinson's make you feel less or that you can't do anything. So I that's my best recommendation.
Very great advice. And thank you again for joining today. That was really fun dancing. The next question is for Dr. Henchcliffe. So you did mention that research is for all stages and all people. What about people who don't have Parkinson's? How can a caregiver, family member, loved one, can they participate and how can they participate?
Oh gosh, what a fantastic question. I'm learning so much today. And this is a really thought-provoking question. So, first of all, you know, I mentioned the stem cell clinical trial. That's for people who've had Parkinson's for a while. And so there is a critical role for a caregiver or study partner. I like the study buddy. That is going to be someone who, if you're off, they're going to help you get into your visit or help you coordinate what needs to be done, just kind of smooth the way. But also, if there's a time, let's say, when you're not feeling up to making a decision, they can help with that. And there are all sorts of ways that can be put into the informed consent. So again, you know, as a patient, what you're signing up for as a participant, and you know what you're having your study partner sign up for. So that's one way. There are studies actually for partners, caregivers as well. And I think one thing that comes up a lot in the clinic, and it's increasingly talked about in the academic field and the research field, it's a horrible phrase, but caregiver burden. I don't really like that term. But how as a caregiver do you best manage all of these kind of conflicting asks that are being made of you, and how do you keep yourself well, and how do you work and find your way through what sometimes a very complex system. And I think the other way, those are just a couple of ways. There are really so many more. But I really love one thing that David said, which is, you know, why would you design a car without input from people who are going to be driving it? And when we had designed this stem cell therapy trial, we not only had patient research advocates with Parkinson's disease, but we also had research advocates who were caregivers, and that was incredibly important for us. But David, thank you so much for bringing that up. I think it's something that we forget about sometimes, but we absolutely need to include the people who have the best knowledge of the Parkinson's. That's people with the Parkinson's and people who help them.
In addition, I think that participants that are caregivers may, or not caregivers, may also volunteer to be controls for studies of Parkinson's disease.
Yes, fantastic. Thank you.
So that's an additional possibility. For example, we cannot discover genes if we don't know what happens in population that don't have the disease. So that is, or a biomarker or whatever. So that is another possibility for people that don't have a specific disease like Parkinson's in this case.
Thank you for adding, that's perfect, yeah.
Can I add a quick comment to Dr. Hinchless's comments about including care partners in as part of the study? That is yet another step in evolution, another improvement in the whole new drug development process. The patient's obvious, like you want to know what they want. The caregiver, who the hell cares? Well, that's exactly who cares. And that's exactly who should be in this. And that's really important to include that in this conversation.
Absolutely. So I wish we had more time. If everybody can just stay tuned for another minute, I think this question is important. So if you could just hang out, I know we'll be a minute over, but you know, we hear this word cure a lot, but what we've heard today is that research is not just about a cure. What I heard, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that research is also about discovering ways possibly to prevent Parkinson's, possibly to treat it better, possibly to slow the progression, and definitely to improve quality of life. So I just wanted to open it up to Dr. Litvan and Dr. Hinchcliffe and everyone, and just sort of, you know, ask you, where do you think we sort of are there? What do you find most promising? Where should we be focusing? Well, I guess start with Dr. Litvan.
I'm very excited about the current knowledge about Parkinson's disease. I think that for the first time, we are at a time in which we know what happens in clinic, how people evolve, and we know what happens when we look at people who passed away and where are the areas that are affected in the brain or in other organs, such as, for example, the GI system. So we also know what happens when these cells are transferred to animals that don't have any disease whatsoever. And everything is going into the same direction. That is, we're learning, for example, in this case, how the disease spreads. And if everything goes into that direction, then search for those particular possibilities. And so we do have now antibodies, for example, that can slow disease progression by scavenging the abnormal proteins. That's the same thing that would happen with COVID, right? We're trying to get to know what the cause of the disease is and then design vaccines, right? Another way, or antibodies that could be given. There is also very exciting genetic possibilities in which we could try to block the development of these abnormal proteins. Mm-hmm. This is extremely exciting for me. So I think we are at a time that is phenomenal. And I think that some of these treatments will get us there. So it's a question of 5-10 years, but we're gonna get there. So it may not be this antibody, may not be this antisense oligonucleotide, maybe not this small molecule, but we're getting there. We're getting there because I think we are in the right path.
I agree 100%. And I just want to add that we may not get there at the same time for everyone. And there may be some, you know, Parkinson's comes in a 100, 1,000, 5,000, 10,000 different flavors, right? And there's one particular sort of Parkinson's associated with the GBA gene. And I sometimes wonder, you know, there's already a gene therapy that I was involved in this when I was in New York. There's already a gene therapy trying to address that. And that's, it's looking at something that wouldn't be a cure straight away, but you can see how it would develop into that. I think the cells, you could think of the way that we're using them now as being, quote, a cure for the motor symptoms, but then you've still got the non-motor symptoms. So Irene, I think some of the things you were bringing up, like this need for precision medicine and kind of picking off areas, you know, groups of people where we may be able to cure or help or make great advances. I think that's really incredibly, you know, it's such an important approach and trying to see who is most amenable to a cure with the technologies that we've got now. And then also realizing, I love that you brought up all of the non-motor parts of Parkinson's, because I think as we're going ahead with the cell therapies, I realized absolutely we are not going to be dealing with the non-motor there. And so I think all of these paths that we're trying to take are very complementary. And I know David brought up a lot of this as well.
May I make a very short comment?
Yes, please.
I want to warn Claire and Irene, we are out to put you out of business.
I would love
that. We're happy for that. We can move on into something else.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be wonderful?
And I love to see success. So every time I see success, oh my God, this is really the best achievement I could have. So yes, I want you to put me out of work.
Me too. And Irene, you and I will go to the beach.
Well, thank you. Thank you everyone for joining and for staying. Thank you, Dr. Hinchcliffe, Dr. Litvin, Dr. Higgins, Lizbeth. We are going to share everybody's information again with you via email. So you can keep in touch. You can look up those studies that are happening at UCI and UCSD. You can stay engaged. You can connect with David. You can connect with Lizbeth. Thank you to our sponsors again, AbbVie, Kyowa Kirin, Boston Scientific, and Amneal. And thanks to our audience for joining. We're going to also, oh, did I mention this is recorded. So we'll send that as well as all of the resources. So you can go back and check. If you had a question that wasn't answered today, please do reach out to us, 1-800-4-PD-INFO. You can use that same information to order any of our free resources. And this concludes the program. Thank you for joining us and stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.